focus on some of the major geographical issues which we frequently face. So these could be related to rising pollution, urban problems, solid waste management, land degradation, as some of those to cite. So let's focus on these one by one. The first is the rising pollution. Now, when we talk about pollution, it is any undesirable substance that is present in our atmosphere, which is pollutant, and that gives rise to a undesirable phenomena. Now, the most common pollutions that we talk about are air, water, and noise pollution. Let's understand these one by one. Noise pollution being the simplest one, we'll understand first. So the noise pollution includes any noise which is beyond the audible range. So beyond the normal decibels that sound is measured in decibel, and any sound which is beyond the usual sound levels or is highly shrill, we would consider that as a noise pollution. So noises coming from factories, from construction sites, from any activities, the demolition sites, the aeroplane sounds, all of those are causes for noise pollution. Now, how can you combat noise pollution? Using earpuffs is one of the best methods that is suggested. And then if you are running a factory or an industry, oiling and gearing of the machines regularly makes the noise pollution decline to a significant level. The other important thing is noise pollution is always location specific. So the intensity would decline as you move away from the source. So moving away from source is another good method. The next is air pollution. Air pollution is due to contaminants being released in the dust, fume, fog, smoke, vapor. So all of those account for pollutants in the atmosphere, and the major sources of discharge for air pollution are industries, again, factories, vehicle exhaust, combustion of fossil fuels, burning of fossil fuels, burning of wood for domestic fuel, and all these pollutions lead to what? They lead to diseases which can affect your respiratory system. So asthma, pulmonary obstructive chronic bronchitis, which we say. So inflammation of the bronchi. And then we also have nervous disorders and brain damage in certain extreme cases that is seen due to rising pollution in the air. The next is water pollution. Now, how does water pollution occur? The domestic sewage, the agricultural waste, the industrial waste, effluents running into the water streams give rise to water pollution. Interesting to note, water pollution is accompanied by thermal pollution. What is thermal pollution? The point where the industries discharge their waste have a reasonably higher temperature than the surrounding waters. As a result of this rising temperature in a given section, the flora and the fauna, the aquatic life of that region is destroyed or affected. Now, this causes an imbalance in the aquatic life or the marine life, and this is one of the consequences that we bear because ecosystem gets disrupted. If the lower order organisms are affected, then definitely the higher order organisms would be affected. So air pollution, water pollution, and noise pollution are the three important pollutions. And as we noticed, all of these three pollutions are notably seen in urban areas. Urban areas is home to all the industries, factories, traffic, vehicular exhaust, and therefore higher level of pollution. Now, again, we talk about acid rain. What is acid rain? To simply explain, with water, if any of the oxides of nitrogen or sulfur combine, it gives rise to nitric acid or sulfuric acid. Both nitric acid HNO3 and sulfuric acid H2SO4 are responsible for acid rain. Now, acid rain, the cases of acid rain, when we see, we have seen a significant change in the pH value, because the pH value, which is 0 to 14, 7 being neutral, any value less than 7 turns out to be acidic. So the pH reduces and the rain, the water that is falling through the rain gets acidic, and therefore it affects the life in the ecosystem. So again, one of the major things that we need to understand because of rising pollution is acid rain. The next important thing that we need to understand because of rising pollution is smog. Now, what is a smog? Simply put, it is a smoke plus fog. In the winter months, we see a lot of fog, and when it is accompanied by smoke, it is called as a smog, which reduces the visibility significantly. So when vehicles are running on the road, if the visibility is reduced, there is higher chances for accidents to occur. Also, this smog is highly dangerous because there are circulatory disorders, respiratory disorders, and nervous disorders caused because of smog. So that is about the rising pollution. Now coming on to a quick summary of what pollutants are involved and what are the sources. So in this table, we have talked about air pollution, water pollution, noise pollution, and yes, one more, the land pollution, which we would understand later in the section on solid waste or the solid disposal. Now, land pollution is mainly through the human waste or the anthropogenic waste, which is human created garbage or the waste that we create. Now, this is what is land pollution. So, higher use of pesticides, fertilizers in agriculture is again responsible for rising levels of water pollution. Now, with the rising level of water pollution, we have seen higher levels of thermal pollution, as we already mentioned, and this thermal pollution would lead to a disturbance in the ecosystem. So any undesirable waste which is produced by chemicals, either from agriculture, so herbicides, fertilizers, pesticides, or the manufacturing plants for these are also responsible for the same. Now let's talk about one of the case studies. If we focus on River Yamuna, which is the tributary of River Ganga, we see that there is lot of extraction of water mainly from this river for the purpose of irrigation in the region surrounding Uttar Pradesh, in the region surrounding Haryana. Now all the agricultural runoff that is going into Yamuna is creating pollution. Now this pollution levels have been so alarming that the domestic and the industrial waste have cumulatively caused Yamuna to become drain in certain areas, and these rising pollution are also attributed not only to the industrial and the agricultural and the sanitation waste, but also due to dumping of carcasses in the river in certain cases. Now whenever the river gets polluted, the river gets infected, there are rising number of waterborne diseases. So typhoid, cholera, diarrhea, hepatitis are all associated with rising levels of water pollution. Now this was a quick understanding of the pollutants. The next important thing that we need to understand is depleting natural resources. Let's take two extreme examples, one from rivers and one from land. In the rivers, we have seen, due to thermal pollution, as we said, the aquatic life gets disrupted. Also, because of creation of dams, what would happen? The flow of the river gets slowed down. So, any pollution that is in the river gets accumulated before the dam and therefore creates a cumulative effect, and the aquatic life is significantly affected, leading to empty net syndrome. Empty net syndrome is a common term which denotes that there are no more fishes left in the water bodies, and the fishermen who are basically focusing their livelihoods on fish catching or aquaculture are now having no more fishes, and this is what is known as empty net syndrome, because the fishermen's net turn out to be empty. There are no fishes to catch. Similarly, on the land, with the process of utilization of land in the various sources, we have seen that food crisis has significantly increased due to degradation of land. Now, how land degrades is interesting. Land degrades because of soil erosion, because of water logging, because of alkalinity, salinity, and creation of wasteland. So the productive parcel of the land now does not have good soil binding or good quality soil that is left because of the erosion. What would happen is these regions start to deteriorate in terms of quality, and as a result the land degradation starts and the natural arable land where once crops were grown now turn out into wasteland. So there are higher proportions of wasteland, and as a result we do not have land for growing crops. This leads to acute food crisis. We have witnessed numerous nations where this acute food crisis has been seen. Now, in India, NRSA or National Remote Sensing Agency based in Hyderabad looks on to the wastelands. These wastelands are generated due to numerous factors. We broadly classify them either as the natural factors or as the human factors. Now, when I say natural factors, it includes the barren rocks, the glacial areas, the coastal areas where land quality is not good. When I say human causes, it includes the land that has been affected badly, waterlogged areas, marshy areas, or the areas which have been affected by salinity, alkalinity. We have seen the case of Indira Gandhi Nahar Pariyojana in the regions of Rajasthan, Ganganagar, where salinity has created acute problems. And once when the canal was made, the region was initially very, very fertile, but in the long run we have seen higher proportions of water logging in those areas. So land degradation takes place either through natural factors or human factors. If we talk about one of the case studies, we take Jhabua as an example. Now, Jhabua is one of the five most backward districts of India, lying in Madhya Pradesh. This region has been known for its acute poverty, and the common people living here are Bhils, the tribes, and they are mainly seen in the regions of Petalwad block. Now, Petalwad block lies in the north of Jhabua region. This is the region where the Bhils came together and they focused on developing the CPR or the common property resource. Now, what is a common property resource? Let's say we have a village here. Now, what are the common properties in the village? A common grazing land, a well, the little forest area which is being maintained by the people of the village. Now, this is a common property. It does not belong to one rural household, two rural household. It belongs to the village, and therefore it is known as a common property resource. So what these Bhils did in the regions of Petalwad block was each of these families came together and said that we would be planting one tree in the common property resource, and as a result the impoverished region turned out to be green. The land that was degraded badly turned out to be green. They planted a lot of fodder, which was also utilized by the cattle of the common people, and this grew as a pasture land, increased the greenery in the region, and the tehsildars brought these rights of the common people under one hand, so the benefits was ultimately shared by the people again. And in this way we have seen wetland development, agricultural development in the regions of Jhabua, one of the very important case studies. The next topic that we focus on is urban waste disposal. Now, what are the problems associated to urban area? Definitely there is a lot of crowding, congestion, we do not have good facilities for everyone, the sanitary conditions are not good, and definitely when all of this happen, the air turns to be foul. Now, in all these cases, what happen is there is higher proportion of solid waste. We have seen metropolitans where 90% of the waste is actually managed well, recycled or disposed properly. However, in small cities and towns, this proportion is only 30 to 50%. That means a lot of waste remains as a dump yard in the cities, creating further problems. What are the solid waste articles? Solid waste articles could be anything, any used pieces of metals, glass, polythene, poly bags or computer waste, e-waste. All of these constitute to solid waste. Household waste could be one criteria, which is called as domestic waste. The other could be the industrial waste. When there is a lot of solid waste, what would happen? This would lead to obnoxious smell, and this smell would attract flies or disease carrying organisms, and typhoid, diphtheria, malaria would be some of the common diseases that could start to precipitate or could multiply in these areas. So if the waste is not treated properly, it can lead to significant problems. Release of toxic gases in the atmosphere is one such important study that we need to understand. So we have a case study of Piranha in Ahmedabad. Now Piranha is considered to be one of the biggest dump yards, and it is believed that the foul and the obnoxious smell or the toxic gases being released from Piranha are so strong that it can reach to the other extreme of the city and lead to corrosion of the AC wiring and ducting. The copper wiring is affected. That means there is so much damage or so much higher levels of toxicity released into the atmosphere, because if this urban waste is not managed properly, it can deplete the air quality and the water quality to significant levels, not only in the region where it lies, but in the neighboring and the vicinity areas. So proper management of urban waste becomes important. The next topic is migration. Very simple to understand. We have a rural area and an urban area. What happens when people in the rural area feel that they are not getting enough employment, or they have sown the seeds for the cropping season this time and they have 3 months left until the crop is ready for harvesting? They aim to migrate to the urban area. In the urban area, they look for various works related to construction activity or any other activities, allied activities, mainly in the unorganized sector. What happens is they get good options there. Now, why? Because in the urban areas where there are growth centers, there is high demand for labor, there is high job opportunity, cheaper labor is required, and this leads to incentive for the labor coming from the rural area. Now these laborers earn certain money. What happens is they send this money as remittance back to their village. So the family which is back in the village can help their child educate, can help their elders get better health facilities, and in this way create a good and an improved living standard. But here what we need to understand is when these workers or people from the rural area move to the urban area, they do not bring their families. There are two primary reasons associated to it. First is the high cost of living, which is seen in the urban area. However, if they ignore that phenomena, the other is their job is either temporary or transferable. Let's take a simple example. A labor from the region of Bihar heard from one of the friends that there is opportunity in the wool factory in Ludhiana, and every hour he would be working, he would get 20 rupees in that factory. So he tends to migrate from Bihar to Ludhiana in Punjab. Now when he is in Ludhiana, he feels that Now, I need to get better opportunities. So, he hears that one of his friend is working in the region of Surat in a diamond factory and is getting around 40 rupees an hour. So, what would happen? He would migrate from Ludhiana from a wool factory to a diamond factory. And in this way, his job is neither permanent. It's a temporary job. It is again a transferable job and mainly the male members are seen in this migratory chain. So what happens is the females and the family are left behind in the village and the primary bread earner moves from one place to another in search of better job opportunities and send the remittance back to their family. Statistics worldwide have revealed that by 2050, nearly 2/3 of the world population would be lying in the urban centers. And therefore, urban centers would become the mainstay of economy. But at the same time, when these urban centers are rising, they would sprawl. That means they would spread haphazardly. Now, when they spread haphazardly, there would be unsanitary conditions, more health issues, crime problems, and rising urban poverty. And this could lead to more people moving into slums. So the bigger the cities, we have seen higher the proportion of slums. Now, how do we characterize slums is one of the things that we would understand. But let's talk about or dive into Dharavi as one of the biggest slums of Asia lying in Mumbai in Maharashtra in India. Now, if we talk about Dharavi, if we know the facts, those are significantly eye-opening because we have only one toilet per 1440 people in Dharavi. Also, the regions do not have sanitary conditions. There are significant number of higher crime levels, poverty, all kind of drug abuse related to poverty. Then this creates a social apathy or social exclusion. There is rising levels of crime, vandalism that is seen in the slums. Along with that, the families do not get ample earning and there is higher level of malnourishment in the children. Lack of literacy. They are low paid workers in unorganized sector and therefore are at the highest risk of any disease that could be carried to their families. And the housing structure is highly dilapidated, and it is said that these settlements, if seen from space, are called as blue tent settlements because if we see a satellite imagery, we would see the blue shades, as you can see in this image, on the roof of the houses, and therefore they are known as blue tent settlements. Also, we need to understand that these slums are the places which originally have one of the worst living conditions in the world, but they are the source for the most fine arts and crafts. Any kind of delicacies that we see in the households, in the open spaces or in bigger hotels, we could say, are coming from these slums. So delicate work, ceramic work, carving, zari work, fine weaving works, metal work, jewelry settings, all of those are done by the people of these slums. However, the amount of labor they are putting is very, very high. In return to that, the salary or the wages that they get are significantly lower. And these slums are called by different names in different corners of the world. In India, we also call these as Jhuggi Jhopadis. So that is the residential areas of least choice. However, there is no other option but to earn their livelihood, they have to migrate from the rural areas to the slums in the urban areas to have their basic livelihood and probably support their families back in the village, which where they can have a significantly better improved living standards and their families could have better healthcare facilities back in the village, or their children could get better school education. So that was about some of the geographical perspectives that we have seen. Over the time, we have seen the issues related to pollution, solid waste management, urban problems, urban sprawl, and slum rising have significantly increased, and these are the issues that need an immediate concern. We would be covering many more topics in geography. Stay tuned. Have a wonderful day ahead.